1 second. Hectoras needs to be able to see out of the window because she will drive me crazy. There you go. Also, the lighting probably just changed a little bit because I opened the window for Hectoras to look outside. What's up, guys? Vasilis from CodingChar here, together with my friend Hectoras. Hectoras, as always, when he senses that something good is about to happen, he wants his ball to be thrown. Today, we will be talking about the input-output and the flow control of a program in the C programming language. Before we start, I would like to kindly ask you to follow us on those social media. See, it's nice now. And also, you can add us on Snapchat. If you've got any questions during this lesson or after this lesson, or whenever you have any programming questions, you can always send us an email to questions@codingjar.org. And let's get to it. So in the previous lesson, we saw a very basic example of how you can print to the screen using the C programming language. I also showed you how you can use dev C++ to compile your program and run it. And now you should have something running, if you have tried this yourself. If you haven't yet, I want to dare you, to double dare you even, to do it. Download dev C++, write your first program, you can do it too. Don't stay in the theoretical space. Get practical, get hands-on. This is what will get you forward. So, now let's talk about printf. Yeah, it's really cool that you can print some nice text messages, but is it that useful? Yeah, it's pretty useful, but I presume you would probably like to print variables, variable values, stuff like that. That would make more sense. So, for instance, if we made a simple calculator application, a user could input 2 plus 5, and then we would output the addition, the sum of 2 and 5. So you wanna print stuff that it's not static. Thankfully, the creators of printf have already thought about that and have implemented this as a feature. So how can we print a variable? This is an example of how you can print an integer, which integer is x, and have its value shown on the screen. You will notice the percent symbol d and the fact that now printf has an extra argument, x. So, the first thing I want you to think about is the following. Yeah, printf is a function, yes? The first argument is the text we want to output. And in the place where we want a variable to be printed, we put a placeholder, a flag, something that printf understands that something, a variable will be there. And then we declare the variable outside the double quotation marks. For every flag printf finds, for every placeholder, if you want, you have to have that many variables with commas, comma separated variables, after the double quotation marks. So if we had %d, %d, then we would need to have comma x and comma some other variable, or comma x again, if that's what you wanna print. There are a lot of different types of variables, so there are a lot of different types of flags. Here, around here, is a table that denotes all those kind of variables. We have the specifiers in the first column, what output this specifier denotes, and an example of what will be printed using this specifier. You can study all this and all material from CodingJar on our website, codingjar.org. I'm not gonna dwell too much on this. I want you to note %d, which is for integers, %c, which is for characters, %f, which is for floating point numbers, and %s, which is a string of characters, which means multiple characters in a row. Apart from printing variables, there are also special characters. Special characters are characters which are not a standard character like a, b, C. You know, the things that get printed. Slash, brackets. They're characters that have special meaning in programming. One of them is changing line. It's the change line special character. But how can we print this? Well, it all starts with how characters are encoded in C. And this is one of the things that when I found out, I was amazed by how it's done and the implications this could have. And how I can exploit this in the future. Some years ago, there was a need to transmit text messages over lines, so to make a transfer. In order to do this, there had to be some encoding for those characters to be transferred over, which is applicable to zeros and ones. For that reason, we created the ASCII, ASCII encoding. In ASCII encoding, every character is assigned a number. So for instance, let me check. Let's go with capital A. Capital A is number 65. Capital B is number 66. Lowercase a is 97. Lowercase b is 98. There's a whole table where all this stuff is apparent and you can see what is assigned to what. But for the first 31 characters, or actually for the first 31 numbers, the characters are not something that is printed, but are special commands that would be received by the receiving end of this transmission, which would be a, let's say, electronic typewriter. Let's put it this way, so it's easier to understand. So, for instance, number 7 would ring a bell on that typewriter. Number 13, if I'm not mistaken, yes, would return the typewriter's head, the carriage, to the beginning of the page. Stuff like that. So, for instance, if you want to change the line, you have first to do a new line, which means change line, and then a carriage return. In C programming, exactly the same thing happens. Characters are encoded as numbers, but instead of using numbers to print our special characters, we use special notations. For instance, if you want to print something and then change the line, you would input your message, and where you want the line to be ended and you change the line, you do a slash n. By the way, I never learned which one is the slash and which one is the backslash. I think that this, which I'm noting right now, should be the slash and the other one should be the backslash. So yeah, I think it's slash n. If it's backslash n, correct me, I am wrong. I know there are comments below, flame as much as you want, but also, you know, comment about things you want to see or you want to ask us. So special characters slash start with a slash character and then something else. So for instance, slash n from new line means start a new line, go to the next line. Slash b means backspace. Slash t means tab character. Here is a list of all special characters. I think that slash a, slash b, slash n, and slash t are the most important ones. Also slash slash, which means print slash, because if you just put slash, it understands that the next character will denote a special character. So if you want to print a slash, you have to go slash slash. To recap, if you want to print a variable, you have to use the specifiers. If you want to print a special character, you have to use the special character notation. Characters are stored as numbers, which means that you could somehow do char x equals 50 plus 13, and that when we would print that, that would print a character, but I wouldn't suggest you doing that. The next thing I want to talk about today is reading from the keyboard. It's really important to be able to read commands, input, text from the user in order to understand what the user is doing and then act accordingly. So for instance, if you had a menu which said press 1 to, I don't know, create an account, press 2 to search, press 3 to exit the program, you would want to know if user inputted 1, 2, 3 or something else. In order to do this, in C programming language, we have the scanf function. It's the exact opposite of printf. Printf prints to the screen. Scanf scans from the input devices, usually and namely the keyboard, and then stores this input somewhere. Where? In a variable, usually. You should also note that in order for scanf to work, then you have to use the specifiers we talked about in printf. So if you wanted to read a decimal, you would go like this, scanf %d. If you want to read a character, you would go like this, scanf %c, and so on. So here's an example. Int x equals 0. Always instantiate and start your variables with a value, because otherwise undefined stuff may happen, and you don't want this. You cannot really know what will be inside your variable if you don't start it with a value. Then we go scanf %d, comma, ampersand x. And now you're all going,
wow, 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 wee! What is this ampersand? You never talk about this, Vasily-san!
Wait, so I know you probably ask about this. I don't want you to understand right now what this is, but I want you to know that in order for scanf to store something in a variable, you need to go ampersand and then the variable name. Let's keep it simple for now. You will find out what this ampersand thing is in lesson 7, where pointers will be explained, alongside with char, star, you know, what we saw in the definition of main. Yeah, let's keep it simple for now. There are more tricks about scanf and what you can input except apart from percent something. Here is a cool link which I will also link down in the description of this video, where you can find material regarding scanf. Okay, so let's do a small recap. We have already found out how printf works, how scanf works, which means we can interact with the user, we can show stuff to the screen, and then we can react to the input from what the user has inputted on the keyboard. And now let's go to the next important thing about in this lesson, the second part of this lesson, the flow control. Flow control denotes in what order and how exactly the instructions will be executed. Up until now, we said that instructions are executed one after the other. Well, flow control allows you to either skip some parts of your code, or execute them when a condition is met, or execute a part of your code multiple times, so loop. And this is what flow control does. The statements we will be showing today are if else, if else if else, the switch statement, for, while, and do while. So some general information about how flow control works is, first it uses Ρα παιδιά, break, otherwise I'm gonna die. I work 8 hours, guys, and then I do this. And then I have to do the editing. And then I have to upload and do all the social media. But to be honest, Maria does the social media part mostly. General information regarding flow control statements. Usually, the flow control statements go as follows. First, we have the statement declaration, so if, while, for, whatever. Then we usually have parentheses, in where inside the parentheses a statement which amasses to true or false is expressed. And then we define a block of code which is to be controlled by the expression and the statement. So we have the statement, the expression which is the control, and the block of code. Let's go with if. If I am hungry, then I will eat. So, the statement is, if parentheses something, block of code, execute this block of code. So, it goes like this. Int x equals 5, int y equals 5, if x equals 5, printf, the variables are equal. The code above will do the following. It will create variables x and y. You probably understand this by now. And then, if the statement inside the parentheses is true, so if x equals to y, then do the following, print to the screen. Easy. Now we're gonna do, if I am hungry, then I eat. Else, I am lying, because I'm always hungry. So, int x equals 5, int y equals 5, if x equals y, then, we don't write then, you don't need to, curly braces, printf, values are equal. Else, and here you did not define a statement, because either the if block of code will be executed, or the else block of code. So it would be redundant to redefine the statement here. So else, curly braces, printf, the variables are not equal. Which in this case they are, and they will be printed as equal. So we will go inside the if statement and not the else. We will go inside the if statement and we will skip the else block of code. The program will continue just below the else. And now we have, if I am hungry, then I eat. Else, if I am thirsty, I will drink. Else, I am lying, because I'm always either thirsty or hungry. So yeah, it's either one of those. Int x equals 5, int y equals 5. If x equals y, then the values are equal. Else if x, so here we define a new statement. If this isn't true, then check the next statement. Else, if x greater than y, printf, variable, whatever, first variable, is greater than the second. Else, if none of the above is true, then values are not equal. And actually, it should denote that y is greater than x, because if it's not equal, and if they're not equal, and if x is not greater, then y is greater. And that's the if else statements work. I guess that's pretty easy. So now we have the switch statement. The switch statement works, in essence, as a series of if statements. Instead of going if x equals 5, then print 5, if x equals 1, then print 1, if x equals 2, print 2, if x equals 8, print 8, you can do the following. We define a switch which will be controlled by variable x. So, depending on the value of x, we execute the following block of code. Case 5. How do you say this? It's a colon. This should be the colon. I'm not sure. In Greek, we say it ano και kato telia, which means upper and lower dot. Let's go with colon. So we have case 5 colon, block of code to be executed, printf. Oh, I've made a mistake here in my slides. It says printf instead of printf. So case 5 colon, printf 5, break. Exactly underneath that, case 1, printf 1, break. Case 2, printf 2, break, and so on. And we close the curly brackets. There is also one more statement, which is called the default. Let's not go into that. And what I want you to remember is when you end with your code that defines a case, so case 5 do something, I always want you to use break. In the future, when you will become a great and awesome programmer, you will learn that break is not always used, it's not... you have to use it scarcely, depending on how you create your code. For the moment, I want you to use it. In essence, what break is, means stop executing the block of code you are inside, so stop executing the switch statement, and then continue your program from underneath the switch statement and onwards. Now we go to the loops. What's loop? Loop is when you have a block of code which you repeat, which means you execute the whole of it and then you go back to the beginning and re-execute until a condition is met. For is a way of doing that. So let's see an example of for and then I will explain it to you. Int x equals minus 200. For x equals 0, semicolon, while x is less than 10, semicolon, x plus plus. And we define a block of code where we say printf percent dx, so print x, the value of x. This will print the numbers from 0, including 0, to 9, including 9, but not 10. So how does that work? The first part of the expression is called the starting condition. The second part of the expression is called the breaking condition. And the third part of the expression is called the loop condition, or loop action, as I prefer to say. All of these names is how I've come up with telling them. They might not reflect how they're officially called, but it works for me and other people understand me. So yeah, let's work with that. The idea is that you would read this statement as follows. For x equals 0, and while x is less than 10, execute the block of code, and after each time you finish that block of code, increase x by 1. That means this starting statement will be executed only when we get to the for statement the first time. Then it will check if the breaking condition is met, which means it will check if x is less than 10. If for any reason x is not less than 10, so for instance if x is 10, the program will stop executing the for block of code and will continue executing the rest commands which are below the for statement. After checking the breaking condition and seeing that it is not met, or actually that it is met, that this amasses to true, it will execute the block of code underneath. And when it finishes executing that block of code, it will execute x++, so it will increase x by 1. That in essence means that we have x equals 0, condition met, prints 0, x equals 1, condition met, prints 1, x equals 2, condition met, prints 2, x equals 3, condition met, prints 3, yada yada yada. X equals 9, is 9 less than 10? Yes, print it, increase x by 1, x equals 10, is x less than 10? No, it's 10, it's not less, it's equal to. This is why the for statement will stop being executed and the rest of the program will start being executed. A small trick I want you to remember is that if you want, let's say, the for statement to be executed 5 times, you would go and write it as is. For x equals 0, semicolon, while x is less than 5, colon, x plus plus. This will execute your code 5 times, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Then, when it gets to 5, it will break. So it will not be executed the 6th time. So if you want your program to be executed n times, you would go x equals 0, x less than n, x plus plus. A really bad example of a for statement is this. All in all, it does all the stuff for does inside the statement in the parentheses and breaks it up. You don't want to do this. This is why we have the parentheses. Sometimes you may have to do this, but not in this case. I have seen it in enterprise code. I don't like it. I still don't understand why it's done sometimes, but it's being done in the professional world. Now, let's move on to the while statement. While I am alive, keep hustling. While Hector is alive, keep playing with the ball. while something is true, do something. This means that while is another loop statement and executes a block of code and while a condition is met, while a condition is true. It's a stripped down version of for. You can't use it with numbers like the for statement, but while, in my opinion, is better used when you use Boolean expressions and Boolean variables. An example would be index equals 0, while x less than 5, printf %d x, x plus plus. But why is it useful? Let's see the following example using both printf and scanf. So int password, let's go here, it's gonna be long. Where's my... somewhere here. So int password equals 3298, int input equals 0. While input is different than password, not equal to password, execute the following. Printf, enter the password. Scanf, %d in input. Then we will check if input, because we go to the top, if input is equal to the password. If it is not, print password will be shown again to the user until the user guesses the password or knows the password, in which case we will break from the while statement and we will print you are correct. I want to put here the correct horse. Here, see it. So another thing you can do is the do while statement. This differs in the following. A do while goes as follows. Do block of statement while semicolon. This means that this block of code will be executed at least one time and then the while check will happen. Then we will check the statement. So it is useful sometimes when you want to instantiate a variable or other stuff. Personally, I don't use it as much. I try to avoid it because I don't know, it's just a preference. I want my code to don't have do. Okay, so we have talked about flow control, but what about flow control control? Sometimes you want to control your flow control. There are two very useful statements, break and continue. We have already seen break, which is stop executing the block of code you're currently inside, the statement, the loop, the switch, the if, whatever, stop executing that and continue your program below that block of code and onwards. Continue works with loop statements. If you have a loop statement and inside there is an if, for instance, x equals some value, and then inside the if you have continue, it will disregard all statements below that and will go back to the beginning of the loop. It will trigger the loop action if you are in a for statement, so x will be increased if you got x plus plus, and it will recheck the statement if it's still true, and it will start the block of code from the beginning. So it's like saying, okay, end this loop, go again to the beginning and execute again. Here are some flow control examples. Here you've got the break example. Here you've got the continue example. Yeah, here's the continue example. So in the first example, if x equals 3, then we will continue onwards. In that case, we will print 0, 1, 2. 3 will not be printed because we broke from the loop. And for continue, the same thing, it will print 0, 1, 2, and 4. 3 will not be printed because we have the continue statement, it will go back to the beginning and, you know, do its stuff again. So, to recap, this was an information-heavy episode. You may have to watch it once or twice again. So, we have printf and printf specifiers, scanf and scanf specifiers, flow control and flow control control statements. Before we close off, if you like this video, please like our video, subscribe to our channel. It means the world to us if we get more subscribers. Comment below with your questions, your remarks, your advice, whatever you may think. Comments are there so you can communicate with us. Also, we got all the social media, you can connect with us. Here is our Snapcode. If you use our Snapcode, you will add us and we will be able to communicate one-to-one with you. And if you got any questions out of this marvelous, marvelous, absolutely fabulous list.
Fabulous. His paper is fabulous. And I think that this is fabulous.
Lesson, you can send them to questions@codingzar.org and I will reply to you personally, probably. It was me, Vasilis from CodingZar. And I want to wish you happy coding, everyone. See you on the next lesson. Bye.